I like the intimacy of this gathering, so we can make it, I mean, it's perhaps like Ken's work, intimate and epic at the same time. So we're quite open to interjections if you really feel compelled to do so. It won't be seen as rude, although if we don't like what you say, we might ignore it. But we will try and throw it out to the floor after 45 minutes anyway. And without putting him on the spot, this is the other Alun. Alun Jones is here tonight, and I don't want to point him out, but he's over there. And Alun knew Ken Price, I've just discovered, really well. And Alun kind of knows everyone. So question to Alun, actually, after 45 minutes, if that's all right, Alun. Great. Alun, it's in some ways a truism, I think, in your world, that whenever an artist works in ceramics, that there is a kind of interrogation about the status of ceramics as art and art as ceramics and the blurring of distinctions and so on. And I'm not sure we should interrogate that much. It's pretty clear that Ken Price was a major artist and a ceramicist and an artist who used ceramics. But I think what is interesting is how he fits into the topography of your world, of the history of post-war ceramics first, and then we'll look at the artistic context as that blurs secondly. So where does he fit?
Where does he fit? Well, I think he has a very important place, as indeed do many others. You're quite right. Some of those kind of debates about the position of ceramics in the wider art world are a bit tired and somewhat unnecessary. I think it seems to me perfectly apparent that the best ceramics are up there with the best of any other medium. On the other hand, of course, you know, there's a lot of prosaic work, as there is in any other discipline. This is just the inevitable consequence of the kind of work that's made. But there are hugely energetic, I think, movements going on in the post-war era, well, indeed, throughout the 20th century, but particularly in the post-war era. And Price is clearly very much a major protagonist in one of those. But as I say, one, I think, is an important thing to kind of state, because obviously the activities in California, particularly around Otis and the School of Vulcus, etc., are kind of vastly important, but it is one of several centres of energy in that post-war period.
Paul Schimmel, the curator of this exhibition, and a distinguished museum director and curator in his own right, and a director of Hauser and Wirth, says that there's a kind of revolution in ceramics in Southern California, and perhaps more specifically in LA, but it does seep out, that really crystallizes by 1960. Does that tie in with your historical analysis?
I think that's right. I think it is true, and there's a lot of different kind of confluence of all different kind of things feeding into that. Central, I think, as the essay kind of indicates, is this idea of ceramics kind of moving into the territory of sculpture. As I say, that is something that happens, you know, in a number of other centres around the world, in Japan, in London, even in the Netherlands with the Cobra Group, etc. So it's happening in kind of different places in the 50s. There's this kind of energy where ceramics is being explored, I think, in ways that are kind of new, to an extent they're kind of new. And it's, I suppose, this idea of kind of radical improvisation that's kind of appearing, and a kind of overturning of canons, and that's happening in a number of places, but certainly happening in California and in LA.
I was aware. I mean, I think many of us have become increasingly aware of, you know, space and light. I mean, I think people who were around at the time knew it was an important movement. I think there's been a re-examination of that, and in fact, Bob Irwin showed together with Ken Price, although obviously Ken was not part of Space and Light, but that, you know, that particular movement, collective movement, broadly speaking, the culture around the Ferris Gallery, you know, Walter Hopps and Ed Keenholz's extraordinary adventure. Otis, you know, the art school. So there's all these art centres, and then you realise that the ceramics revolution that is talked about includes people like Billy Al Bengston, who's also seen as part of the nascent California scene. And Ken Price is the pivotal figure in all of that. Now, that's very varied. But if we look at the influences on Ken Price's work, one realises, in fact, that he was an artist open to a whole plethora of influences. I mean, I think you might say that many artists, or most artists are, but the way that they distill them tends to move towards a kind of consistent vision, at least at the beginning. One of the things that strikes me about seeing this exhibition is that, I mean, there are certain things about Ken Price that we can come on to later. Touch might be one of them, eroticism, role of drawing, that are trademark if you look closely. But he's very pluralistic in reference and effect and process and, over a long career, is how I see it.
I think that's true. I think it is interesting to kind of analyse what some of those influences are and to understand how they kind of come together and some in some ways appear to be kind of in conflict, in other ways they seem to be kind of in sympathy. It is quite, there is a kind of eclecticism, and I think that it comes through the range of influences that come to him. It perhaps seems kind of more perhaps eclectic to somebody that's outside the world of ceramics than those that are kind of immersed in it, I think, because he is clearly comes under the influence of Vulkas, and perhaps you should say something about Vulkas,
yes,
just to kind of contextualize it for people. So Vulkas is this kind of very energetic young guy, really establishing quite an extraordinary kind of dynamic career in the early 1950s as a potter.
He's Black Mountain, he's Montana,
yeah,
and comes to LA in 1954.
That's right. And he's already kind of recognized as a highly talented ceramic artist, and that's why he gets the kind of the teaching posts at Montana, at the Archie Bray, 52, then teaches a little bit at Black Mountain, and then gets asked to set up this studio in what's later called OTIS, the Los Angeles County Art Institute. And he really kind of creates an environment, you know, where there's an amazing kind of energy, and he's working alongside his students, doesn't have his own separate studio, so he's there making. And he takes on this extraordinary array of talented students. Paul Soldner, I think, was the first, and then people like John Mason and Ken Price, obviously, and others. So he creates this kind of amazing energy around him, and it's quite a kind of male environment. I think it's, you know, it's kind of muscular work that's being made, and it's really kind of making things that are, you know, very, very robust sculptural objects and pushing ceramics in that direction. But it's also very much influenced by Vulkas's appreciation of certain aspects of Japanese ceramics, and the kind of interest in chance effects that you get in Japanese ceramics, and certain kinds of rugged surfaces that are very, very revered in Japanese ceramics. And Vulkas encounters Hamada and Leach, but I think Hamada has a kind of huge influence on Vulkas in a way, in a kind of way of thinking. So this all kind of feeds in, and then this is kind of coming into Price's work as well, this kind of experience of Vulkas's circle and that kind of energy. But at the same time, he's picking up maybe slightly distinct things from Japanese ceramics, and he's also picking up ideas about kind of finish and surface and color and the joy of color, and these kind of almost are kind of layered on top of this experience that he has at Otis. And he gets that by going to Alfred in New York State and actually learning a kind of certain range of technical skills. So as there often is in ceramics, there's this kind of interplay between the idea of a kind of looseness but also a kind of a basic knowledge of technology and craft skill, and these things are kind of put together to create some quite extraordinary objects.
That is very interesting, that my perceived pluralism you're saying is almost a truism in the way that ceramics was being taught in the late 50s, early 60s in Los Angeles.
I think there's a certain number of influences that are coming in, and people are kind of picking up slightly different things from them in different ways. It's really interesting, the kind of range of sources that seem to be coming into Price's work in this kind of period. I'm not seeing the screen behind me, so I'm not seeing what's coming up, but there's a fantastic pot. It's like almost one of my favorite, well, possibly my favorite object in the exhibition, because it's such a brilliant kind of starting point, is this piece called Avocado Mountain, which is this wonderful kind of green, deep green, quite kind of biomorphic form that is actually still a pot. I think it's got a little tiny lid.
It's a breast
thin
well.
In the top. It's I think it probably is, and not the only one in the show. I'm sure. And I think that's a really fascinating object. And Sam Thorne in the essay, in the wonderful essay in the catalogue, talks a little bit about it, and he makes references to kind of Art Brut in relation to that object.
Absolutely.
And that's a kind of a really interesting point, I think, to make in terms of ceramics, because Sam connects it to this moment where Price goes off and sees an exhibition of work by
Dubuffet,
Bacon,
Soulage,
and interestingly, I think particularly Carol Apple. And I don't know whether he was aware of Apple's work in ceramics, but Apple, as part of Cobra, was making some really, really radical interventions in ceramics, you know, in about 5 years earlier, 54 or something, working in Albasola. And so kind of one wonders how much, you know, Price is aware of that kind of ceramic activity as well, and this kind of almost, you know, as I say, kind of global idea of kind of radical improvisation that's kind of picking up in different sites. But then the other thing that interests me particularly about that object, I think, is that, you know, probably to most people in the room or most people that see the show, they might think it's quite a kind of dull object. It's not the most vibrant thing, you know, in the show. But I think in ceramic terms at the time, it's not fetishizing the same kind of surfaces that other ceramic artists might. It's not a kind of a, you know, reduction fired glaze or anything like that. It's actually quite a kind of slick glaze over a fairly rugged object, but it's quite a slick glaze. So actually, to me, rather than it kind of contrasting with the other work in the show, it actually seems to be the starting point of a lot of the other work in the show that's heading towards that kind of quite slick finish that you see playing out in many of the objects throughout it. So that's something that I think is very particular to Price.
I don't think it's dull at all, but I know what you mean. If you see it reproduced in relationship to many other things, it's not, for want of a better word, the sexiest object, although it is actually very sexy and sensual once you look at it. The thing that I remember when you and I were looking at it recently, having seen the show and then looked at it in reproduction, I'd forgotten how big it was. And obviously the reproduction hints it might be kind of slightly bigger than a cup. I remember it being about that big, but of course it's about that big. And I think his use of scale and the way he plays with scale, I mean, I joked at the beginning, but I think the intimate and the epic, the monumental and the micro and macrocosmic, I think he has a really wonderful facility with that. And that's not just to do with form, it is also to do with process and colour and surface and texture and so on. He seems remarkable to me in that way.
I think that's right, and I think in a way that kind of does mark him out, or at least shows a kind of his own agenda as different from, certainly from Vulcus and Otis, this idea of something jewel-like, something quite kind of, well, specialness, that's a word that I was going to wanted to come onto almost and talk about. That piece has that kind of extraordinary scale, and I wonder whether that's still, you know, still some kind of hangover perhaps from that monumentality that he was experiencing kind of earlier on. But there are extraordinary changes of scale when you move around the show and you look at the catalogue and you see some pieces illustrated and then you see them and they're absolutely tiny, and then other ones, as you say, that kind of defy your expectations slightly. But I think kind of constantly throughout it, you have this sense of the objects having this specialness about them. And I think that's, there's something almost subversive about the use of the small scale and intimacy, you know, that draws you in and gives the work a kind of a focus that that a larger scale work wouldn't have. Actually, nothing in the show is absolutely huge. I mean, nothing gets actually very much bigger than the avocado piece, which is kind of interesting in the context of most artists that are trying to make, you know, what you call ceramic sculpture, because quite often one of the strategies is to scale up. It's an obvious one, but it isn't always effective.
No. I suppose the other thing is that comes from the avocado piece is texture and process. And I don't know whether to you process is writ large across his oeuvre, but I found myself not being able to decode, or rather that wasn't the first thing that I started to look at when I looked at the work. And yet it becomes clear when you know that in the later work there's that the alcohol soaked swabs that start to blur the colour, that there's 12 up to 12 layers of colour on occasion, that there's dry sanding that he also uses, that I love the reference of Dave Hickey's, that probably came from surfboard workshops. So there's this whole variety of different processes, some of which are ceramic, some of which are, you know, you could say the Finnish fetish of some of the Southern Californian arts, and some are the, you know, the surf stuff that he and Billy Albankston were doing when they shared a studio together and were surfers, and as he remained later in his life.
I think the he's clearly was an incredibly skilled artist. I mean, there's no doubt about that. There's a huge kind of technical facility and evident in many, most, all, almost of the works, and I think that's an interesting kind of aspect. You know, you almost have the sense that sometimes that in order to move away from what might be perceived as a kind of craft territory, you have to, within ceramics at least, one has to kind of abandon the obvious use of skill, but actually skill is so kind of evident in many of the pieces. But nevertheless, it's kind of unorthodox skill, or at least it's unconventional in certain ways. Even the use of, you know, the use of acrylic, the use that use of cold painting and abraded surfaces, it's not conventional kind of ceramic processes necessarily. Although actually, in some ways, it kind of almost emulates certain, you know, those later pieces. To me, they almost look glazed, but as soon as you can examine them more closely, you realise that they're not. It's this kind of fantastic layering of the paint and abrasion, and it is extraordinary work.
I love that quote from Bob Irwin. He felt that he always felt when he looked at Ken Price's work that if you cut it in half, the colour would be saturated all the way through.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. And I think there's certain pieces that you'll see, actually pieces like this, but not the drawing, of course, that you see that really have that appearance. And it is really quite an extraordinary feeling that it gives you. It makes the piece almost look, I think, kind of like some precious stone that's been cut, and you just you have a belief in what's inside.
We sometimes have to take respectfully what artists say with a pinch of salt. They can be as much prone to myth making or smokescreen creation as the rest of us. But when Ken Price says that the purpose of his work is strictly for pleasure, I wonder where you stand on that.
I think I believe him. I mean, there's a lot of joy, I think, in the exhibition, and I think there is. I mean, there's a lot of pleasure to be gained out of material objects. I think that is a reality. I think it's a reality that people in the applied arts kind of actually understand very, very well. Serious play, and I think that is there. And you know, there's no reason necessarily that great art should not be joyous as well. And I think it absolutely is. I mean, it's hard to walk around the show and not kind of smile, you know, for most of the time.
A shadow side? I mean, it would be very reductive to say those plates in the pollution series, which in some ways acknowledge the fact that Los Angeles is a polluted city, a smog-ridden city, a city with problems in that sense. And if you just move from Taos, as he did in the early 90s and then he went back in the latter part of his life, you may feel that the air is completely different as it is.
Yes.
I mean, of course there is an environmental message, but I'm not reductively saying that is the dark side, but there's an element, I suppose,
there
in the main, the pleasure principle predominates.
It does. I think they're the things that almost, they're kind of jarring almost. I mean, in a positive way, I think, because they have that kind of message, but when you're moving around the show, it's kind of like a sudden jolt to encounter that. It's like the sun has been obscured, and literally, yes. I guess.
The erotic dimension is a fascinating one because, I mean, it's clear, and I think he seems hedonistically to be celebrating that fecundity, fertility, biomorphic form, and so on, which we should look at and talk about. But also, there is the private aspect, I think, of eroticism, particularly in the drawings. He always said that the erotic drawings were private, and in one of his landmark shows, 1978, Lacma, Happy Curios, again, which we'll talk about in a minute, he decided, I think, for reasons of pragmatism, to self-censor, to leave them out, because there'd already been a great sort of a furore over Ed Keynolds's work, and so he decided to leave them out, because they were private things that he didn't want to be the cause of major public debate or discussion. Do you think there is a discernible distinction between private eroticism of those drawings and the more fecund public sensual eroticism in the sculptures, or is that a false dichotomy? It's an impossible question.
It's
I'm glad I threw it at
you. I think that's actually, it's not just about the erotic drawings, though, is it? I think there's something kind of private about the body of work of the drawings overall. You have a sense, I think, that he's making the drawings for himself. His own kind of pleasure, whereas I think the ceramics is kind of staged in more in the public domain, in the public arena, I think. That's what I feel.
Yeah. Although there are some drawings that are clearly technically working things out, and there are others that are kind of a laboratory of exploration, and then there's the private dimension. There's a range of things, and I was fascinated to discover that some of the drawings, which you would think were studies for or the resolution of a ceramic work or a sculpture, actually were made after the event, which is actually relevant to Van Gogh doing those extraordinary reed drawings, ink drawings after paintings. So in some ways, I love the lack of consistency, maybe is the wrong word, but there is a fluid approach to drawing as there is to process a material.
Absolutely, and I think that's possibly why I have the sense that it is more of a kind of private domain for him. I mean, I don't think it was until the late 70s that he exhibited any drawings, as far as I'm aware. And so anything presumably preceding that was for his own purposes, either working through ideas or kind of providing these kind of fantasy images, like those extraordinary, the wonderful kind of turtle cup swimming through the sea, which is such a kind of wonderful dreamlike kind of image. I think it has all of the kind of clarity of a kind of a dream image. And that's, I think, is quite distinct to the ceramic work, which actually has more ambiguity and more kind of fluidity about it, in a sense. But you're quite right. I think the drawings appear to serve quite different purposes. But maybe for ceramicists, drawing is used in those different kind of ways. I mean, I know quite a few ceramic artists who routinely document their work, not through photography, but by drawing it after they've made it. Seems to be some kind of closure almost, you know, by doing that.
Many artists are great installers or hangers of their own work. Some aren't. Some are not that interested in it. Many are. Ken Price, from the installation shots that I've seen, was obsessed with it and wonderful at it.
Yeah.
It may be that the Happy Curios was more of a collaboration than we know, but certainly his authorship of that exhibition in particular, of which we have some installation shots, is remarkable, because the framing devices, which I think you should talk about, were almost intrinsically part of the work, and there's all sorts of interesting precedents for that, not least Japan, I suppose.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I think that particular show, I think, was revolutionary in various different ways, probably. But if you look at Price's own trajectory, you can see that he's already showing an interest, I think, in the way the work is presented, in the framing of objects. And you can see that within individual objects. Less so, I think, in pieces that are in this exhibition, except for there's a wonderful drawing of a piece called Specimen, which comes up occasionally, and it's like kind of a red shelf kind of structure with this little egg-like, rather kind of, again, with some kind of, well, kind of vaginal seeming kind of, opening on it. And again, so you have this idea that he's thinking about how the work is displayed, how it's framed, and I think that comes from an experience of looking at Japanese work. But there are precedents in ceramic history earlier in the century for artists, architects, thinking about the framing of ceramics. If you go back to Vienna and Joseph Hoffmann, for example, there's a lot of thinking going on about how ceramics are presented in different contexts. But I think Price kind of distills it into this kind of wonderful, postmodern moment when he, obviously with this wonderful kind of fascination for Mexican folk pottery and the shops that are selling it, creates this wonderful kind of shop-like environment in the exhibition, where the display methodologies are kind of as important as the objects, wonderful as the objects are. So I think it is a really interesting kind of moment of an artist really considering the framing of their work, and that really kind of plays out, I think, in subsequent decades, numerous artists. I think the idea of the artist in control of the presentation of their work, many, many ceramic artists today, I can see one sitting not very far away from me, gives great thought to the idea of how work is presented. And I think, it's an important moment in that history, and I think that's become a really significant part of contemporary ceramic practice.
You mentioned the Mexican folk pottery and the curio shops, and on those surf trips and going back to Tirana and seeing those shops and acquiring that work, but looking at again at the ways it was displayed. All sorts of parallels have been made with happy curios in the context of what was happening in the broader American art world at the time. There were some interesting references. I mean, the obvious one is Klaus Oldenburg's store, although the individual component parts weren't for sale. The other one, which is kind of another manifestation of the sublime, not from the sublime to the ridiculous, but from the sublime to the sublime, is Jim Terrell's Rodin Crater. Now that's an odd, what on earth is the parallel? But I think what Paul and Sam Thorne and others, when that was mentioned, what they were getting at was this obsessive, all-embracing project that potentially could have no ending, because yes. The Happy Curios was, although it was in the
Happy's
context...
Happy's Curios, we should say, Happy's yeah, Curios,
Happy's Curios, sorry, yes. Yeah, sorry. It was in the context of LACMA in 1978, but it could have been expansive, it could have been ongoing, in a sense it was ongoing, it was realised for the next exhibition, but then it was unrealisable, or he continued to try and realise it throughout his career. So it has that kind of epic quality, I suppose.
I think that's right. I mean, I think he did have the expectation originally that it would be presented in 72, 73 or something, and then it was at least 5 years after that. So, but as you say, it is just a kind of big ongoing epic project.
And Happy, of course, is his wife.
Yes.
So Happy's Curios. Yes. Thank you. Something about a dry mouth.
Although they are Happy Curios as well, I think absolutely.
I think they are
absolutely.
There's again an analysis, I think, after the event, and people like Douglas Dryspoon, when he worked with him at the Albright Knox, re-explored that exhibition and talked about the work and the approach and the perception of it hovering between cynicism and critique. So we can unpick that, but also making the point that Price's sculpture and that project in particular was amongst the earliest manifestations of postmodernism in ceramics. You mentioned the POMO word a few minutes ago, but is that, I mean, is he a pioneering postmodernist?
I think through that endeavour, it seems to me that he perhaps is, although I certainly don't see a lot of irony or cynicism evident in it myself.
No, I don't know.
Again, there seems a lot of joy in it.
There's a kind of knowingness in framing and reframing and pushing at the frame and the picket fences, but I agree,
yeah.
it is more affectionate critique than a kind of, it's not a parody, is it?
It's not a parody, and I think it's interesting how, we talked about kind of craft skill earlier on, but how beautifully crafted those cups are. I mean, they're lovingly created and decorated. I think you have to say that. Looking at them, it's not a slapdash endeavour that's undermining the source material that he's making reference to. It seems to me that there's a lot of love for that, for the pottery that he's making reference to.
Another impossible question. Sorry, I've just cast myself totally in the role of throwing questions at you. It is a conversation, but the best conversations are where the person who knows most that answers the questions. I have never felt that the notion of didacticism is a problem. You know, I believe in education, and certain things can be more didactic than others by definition. But if a work of art is described as didactic, it's often seen as a huge badge of dishonour amongst certain people. Ken Price taught. He was, you know, he's head of the ceramics department from the early 90s at the University of Southern California. He had some extraordinary teachers. He remained clearly open to those influences and was clearly a great teacher and mentor throughout his life. Is there a didactic element to his sculpture, do you think, or to his drawings in ceramics? Or is that actually a blind alley or a dark alley?
I guess I don't see that, because I think there is such a kind of that sense of kind of the person, the man, and what kind of floats his boat that's kind of in the work. I don't feel that he's you don't really get the sense that he's necessarily thinking too heavily about the audience. You know, I think he makes it for the joy of making it, and possibly the hope that I mean, perhaps Alun will know this, knowing him, but it seems to me he's an artist that has made what he wanted to make, and probably hoped that somebody would like it, but wasn't trying to kind of push any particular kind of agenda. And I think the idea, I don't know, the idea of him being a significant teacher and clearly operating in these circles where in educational establishments, I mean, it is such a feature of, well, probably wider visual arts practice, but certainly ceramic practice, where, you know, artists teach, they make that contribution. I think it's kind of, it's almost, you know, a default position, I think, of kind of giving in that kind of way, which is only a good thing.
Alun, sorry about this. What was he, in his, I mean, if he was here now, and we started talking to him, was he energetic, laconic, didactic, completely laid back? How was he as an individual?
He was a very gregarious, sort of relaxed character who would be most likely stretching back in his chair now and jamming a big cigar in his mouth as he parried the questions. He shared that in common with his counterparts in California. I mean, it was such a different ethos there, the art scene. And there was a lot of
braggadocio, a lot of macho stuff. I thought that it all came from Groucho Marx, who they all adore. And I was a non-smoker, but they all had these big cigars generally. And then I was introduced and met Cliff Westerman and realized that he was their idol, because he too had the cigar. But he was not an angst-ridden person in terms of the way he presented himself to the world.
I like the description of the kind of laid-back underlying machismo, and I think that's absolutely right. The descriptions of that art scene certainly reinforce that. But people like Bob Irwin, Larry Bell, they're cigar-smoking, Larry is, kind of men's men, but actually there's a sensitivity to them as human beings and artists, and certainly in Ken Price's work it is not overweeningly macho, is it?
I don't think that. No, I agree. I agree completely. Yeah.
Right, so we've now thrown it to the floor. Feel free to ask us questions or make points or ask Alun questions. Thanks, Alun, it's great. It brought it to life. I love the idea that they're influenced by Groucho Marx. I suppose the notion of humour is also interesting, because if they adored him, they had a sense of humour. And there is an underlying humour and wit to the work, isn't there? It's not work that takes itself too seriously, but it is very serious work.
Absolutely, I think that's right. It does, as I said, I think it kind of makes you smile, you know, as you go around the show and you look at different works, and I don't think that undermines its kind of seriousness at all. I think there's quite a few ceramic jokes in there as well. It seems to be, I mean, in terms of ceramic history and things being kind of referenced in different objects, and that's clearly a delight to him. I think it's a delight to anyone that looks around the show.
It is great to see a show in London, because it hasn't been one.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
On which note, we should all retire to the show, have a drink, and carry on the discussion. But the formal part of the evening is now concluded. And Alun, you've been enlightening and profound and good-natured, and you should have kicked back some of my unfair questions. Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.